concept I want to tell you is about the type of a polarization. So that will come into our picture later, but now we have all these definitions. If you have E be an alternating form representing a polarization, L on A, so A is a quotient. So there is a, how's the name? There is a theorem that tells you that there exists a basis of elements. Yes, someone has the answer?
No.
Okay. Either exists a basis of elements on the lattice. Mm-hmm. And so it's a basis of B as a real vector space with respect to which you write this E is given by the matrix . So you can always find a basis such that E looks like that. T minus T zero. So this is a 2G matrix. 2G matrix. So this is a basis. So let me put it. Basis of B as R vector space. Such that D is a diagonal matrix with elements in diagonal D1, DG, and every DI divides the next one, DI plus, DI plus, for E, we start in 1, 2, G minus 1, okay? This is the condition. And from now on, I will just work and concentrate on line bundles that they are ample. And so in particular, this is non-degenerated. Yes. So all the DI has to be positive. Non-degenerated, bilinear form. Okay. They are all positive. And that's right. So there is a full theory of so looking at all line bundles, even this, all the line bundles, right? But for me, I will concentrate on those ones. And these numbers is a discrete invariant on our abelian variety. So this is the vector d1 dg is called the type of the polarization. The polarization. This is another important concept. Mm-hmm. And and we say that the polarization is principal. Is principal if the type is, if it is of type. It is of type 1, 1, 1, 1. So you have as many ones as the dimension. Yeah. So remember, this is a real dimension, and a complex dimension is G. So you have G is the dimension of the abelian variety. So as usual, we have also a Riemann-Roch theorem. Mm-hmm. Let me see how it, there are several versions. So in our case, Riemann-Roch, Let's concentrate L non-degenerated and positive definite, yeah, as you say, positive definite. With positive definite chain class, the Euler characteristic of this line bundle is just the Pfaffian of E. The Pfaffian of E is the square root of the determinant. So in this case, it's just the product of the elements on the of DEIs. Okay. So the determinant of E is the Pfaffian of E square. Okay. So yes, so actually that corresponds. So you know the Euler-Poincaré characteristic of is defined as the alternating sum of the dimensions of the cohomology groups A0 of minus one nu from A0 of A H, sorry, no, A L. But in that case, all except the A0 is gonna be zero. So this in this case is just A0 of A L. But just to mention that there is a more general theory. But in our case, when L is non-degenerated and the channel class is positive definite, all my eigenvalues is positive. So all cohomology groups vanishes and only the H0 survives. And yeah, let's keep it simple. Mm-hmm. Moreover, we can also compute the degree of EL. So this is also the isogeny of EL is given by the determinant of E. So this is the Pfaffian. Yeah, the Pfaffian square. So the Euler characteristic square, it coincides with the degree of this map. Okay, so there is a relation also between the Euler-Poincaré characteristic and the degree of EL. Okay. I won't say more. Of course, this is all included in a course, abelian varieties. But you see, what is nice is that you can read the Riemann-Roch H0 of a polarized abelian variety from its type of the polarization. Okay, it's very simple. Now let's go to the examples. So let's start from something in dimension one. And I'm sure you have seen this picture, maybe. So you are in the complex plane. In the complex plane, see, we have a lattice. So every lattice is given by, can give a basis of a lattice. So we can fix that one basis is one. And the other is an imaginary number tau, or imaginary complex numbers such that, so very, very important, you want the imaginary part of tau is different from zero because you want the linear independent with one. Okay, so you can choose a basis like this. And don't do that. Okay. Where are we? Oh God, it was not safe. God, okay. Sorry about that. So let's start again. Examples. So So he has the complex. So let's do G1s. G1. So you take, it's not so straight, but you have, you have one as an element of the basis, and the other is tau. The imaginary part of tau is positive. And then you copy, you translate these vectors. It's not too. So it's a little bit, it's supposed to be a little bit shift, but so you copy the so you translate these two vectors in with Z, so plus, minus, and then you cover you generate a lattice, you generate a lattice in C, right? And you are looking for the quotient of, so this is, let's see, the lattice. The lattice is generated by tau times Z. Those are the points of the lattice times Z. One. Okay. And so you ask what is the quotient? So the quotient of C over this lattice. Well, it has to be compact, first of all. So you copy. So every element in the quotient has a representative in this fundamental parallelogram. And moreover, you can, this side is identified to this side because it's a translation by an element of the lattice, and this side is identified with this side. So you glue both sides. First of all, you get a cylinder where you have glue here, this side, and then you glue these two sides together to obtain a torus. So this is the torus. Okay, that's right, identified. So this is the picture of CA, and this picture comes with two elements of the basis. So on one side, let me call the image of these sides of the parallelogram. One, call it lambda. Let's see, I have names for that. Well, actually, it's one and tau. So for instance, this here, it was the image of one, yeah. And this here is the image of tau. Okay, so actually they are also elements on the first homology of the torus. Okay, so in the basis one tau of C, this is V. We have a bilinear form V. Mm-hmm. Into A, given by this matrix, given by the matrix as well. That. Which is actually the intersection form. Mm-hmm. That corresponds. So this is the intersection form. Intersection form. And in the first homology group on the first homology group from the quotient, let's call it C. Yeah, E for elliptic. Mm-hmm. Into Z. And that is well known that this is isomorphic to Z2. And the basis is these two loops get well. So every you can yeah you can define an intersection form on the closed paths defined over E, and this is in this matrix. So so this is what we call an elliptic. This is an abelian. This is a principal. Okay, we have here. We have here, thanks to this form, we have defined a principal polarized abelian variety of dimension one, which is just the same thing as an elliptic curve. So elliptic curve meaning the genus of the curve, the associated curve is one. So it's given by a one whole topological invariant here, G equals one. So the difference essentially between elliptic curve and a principal polarized abelian variety is that the dimension one is in this, does in this side we have a privileged element called zero. There is a zero over there. And the elliptic curve, well, we don't have a privileged point zero, but yeah. But once you fix the zero, every elliptic curve is an abelian variety of dimension one. Okay. So more. So in this baby case, this is the baby case. The line bundle. What is the line bundle? What is the polarization? I give you an incarnation polarization via the bilinear form, given by the intersection form. But I can give you also the line bundle. The line bundle is given by this point zero. Is the sheaf such that the divisor is the zero divisor? So yeah, that is so zero as divisor, right? A divisor on E. Okay. Moreover, and you take three times L, so tensor three times, this is the sheaf three times this point zero. This is a line bundle of degree three, because that is of degree one, yeah, of degree three on a curve. And by Riemann-Roch, so this had exactly three sections. So actually, A0 of L has one section, and A0 L three times has three sections. And this is as I mentioned, that is already very ample. Very ample, that means that with this line bundle, you can embed your elliptic curve in P2. So in the A0 of CL tensor three, this is a P2. And actually the embedding given by this is an embedding of degree three. That means that the elliptic curve is always a plane cubic. You can see, yes, it's a plane cubic. Okay, which is also very nice. So
Angela, when you write C, you mean E, right?
Yes. I am so in love with C that is E. E for elliptic. Thank you. Okay. So I also want to remark, I forgot to say that by Riemann-Roch, so the Riemann-Roch, the number of sections is given by multiplication by the multiplication of the type of the numbers on the type of the polarizations. So in particular, so if the line bundle is principal, that means that it has only one section up to multiplication by scalar. Okay, and it's if only if. Okay, if you have only one section, and that means that the polarization is of this type 1 1 1 1 1. Okay, only one section, and this is very important. Well, very important. It's nice for geometry because one section means only one effective divisor on the abelian subvariety. So the principal polarized abelian varieties come canonically with a subvariety, one unique subvariety inside there. Well, you can do geometry. If it's not principally polarized, you get a linear system and you get many other objects. So this is why we like principally polarized, but this is not the reason to not to study the other ones, as we will see. Right, so this example generalized to higher dimension. Higher dimension. So you can do the same thing. Historically is the first example of an abelian variety, the Jacobian of a curve. Actually, how this is how we Abel and Jacobi discovered, so to say, the abelian varieties, because they first discovered the Jacobian. So they tried to understand how to integrate over this. Yeah, well, this is a long story, but yeah, the way up to integrate hyperelliptic functions is to consider in the quotient. Okay, so let's be see. Let's see. P a projective smooth projective. Sorry. So smooth projective algebraic curve. Mm-hmm. So if you prefer, people prefer to call them Riemann surface. And such a smooth projective algebraic curve has a first homology group. It's always an abelian group set diffeomorph to set to G, where G is the genus of the curve. Mm-hmm. So okay, let's have a little recall. You have a curve. So the complex version of a curve. You can have more, but looks like this. You have some holes in the curve. So for instance, you have three holes. So this is the genus of a curve, the number of holes. And so for each hole, you have two elements on the cohomology, on the homology. So two loops, one here, yeah, and one in the other direction, like we did for. Mm-hmm. Okay. So just to make sure what we are talking about, this is the group of, this is the group of closed paths in C. So how you construct it? Well, you take a point P0 and then you go all the closed paths. So up to, yeah, modulo homology. So two curves, this curve, this path is essentially different to the other, but this because this captures a hole and this doesn't. Okay, this is contractive. And so, okay. so the point is that this homology group can be seen as a lattice inside of the holomorphic, in the dual of holomorphic differentials. So we have a map. From omega C into H0 of C, omega C dual. So this is the vector space of holomorphic differentials on the curve on C. So this is naturally isomorphic to CG. So it has dimension, the genus of the curve. And then you go, how do you go? You take, the limitation is lambda or gamma. Yeah, you take a closed path gamma and you associate it to that, the linear functional that it takes an holomorphic differential omega. And what do you do with holomorphic differentials? Well, you integrate them along this path. And that's define an element in the dual space, okay? And it turns out that this map is injective, right? So we can see this lattice is a full rank lattice inside of this vector space. So they define the Jacobian of a curve of C is the complex torus. So let's put this is the quotient of morphic differentials modulo this lattice. So the image of this lattice inside. Mm-hmm. So this is isomorphic too. Okay, but this is not so important. Important is this definition. Moreover, the dimension of this abelian variety is the dimension of the holomorphic differential, is the genus of the curve. Okay. And the intersection product that I mentioned before defines the polarization. Intersection product on H1. Mm-hmm. So H1 C Z times H1. It said to takes integer values. So you take two paths and you associate the intersection of these two paths, right? So for instance, this is zero if they don't intersect. This is one if they intersect in one point in with the right directions. And this induces an alternating form. So you can always choose the basis like here. How I put it. So this is called gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3. And this is mu 1, mu 2, mu 3, for example. If you choose it like this, the alternating form in these spaces looks like you have a matrix. It's actually is the identity of size G minus identity. Okay. So this one means that the loops lambda intersect with the mu in one point, yeah, in this order, only with one. And this means that if you change the order, they this is minus one, they in the order in one the multiplication. So that gives you a principal polarization. Mm-hmm. And actually we work very much with the divisor version of the polarization. Mm-hmm. Denoted by theta. So there is one unique divisor in the Jacobian up to translation, but this is there's canonical associated one that's a divisor giving this principally polarized, given the principal polarization. Okay. So the Chern class of L is E, and this the polarization is O theta divisor. Okay. In particular, it has only one section. Theta is one section. Okay. So what happened with the elliptic curve that we saw at the beginning? Well, in that case, the Jacobian, you don't have to do anything because the Jacobian of an elliptic curve is the curve itself. Elliptic curve is isomorphic to itself. Okay, to the curve itself. Okay, let me see. Yes, we are very much behind on my program. okay, is there any question? No. Okay. So let me tell you about Abel Jacobi map. Okay. So as I said, pick zero. I talk about pick zero of the abelian varieties, but we can also take pick zero of a curve. So again, is the group of line bundles of chain class zero, but this is in at the level of the curve. This Neron-Severi group is isomorphic to Z actually. And this number is just to the degree of the line bundle of degree zero on C. And as you might know, that it can be also constructed as the quotient of all the divisors, the group of all divisors on the curve of degree zero, modulo principal divisors. So divisors that define it from functions, okay? Okay, so we define the Abel-Jacobi map. Mm-hmm. Alpha. So there are very ways of defining it. Let me keep you this one. You take a divisor of degree zero on C, and you can go to the Jacobian the following way. So take a divisor. So divisor is what? It's a, oh, sorry. How do you? Okay, sorry about that. So usually nobody calls me. Ah, here, I can do that here. Ah, yes. So you take the sum, okay, you can write it as something like this. So difference of points. So to be sure that it's of degree zero. And then, so what is the Jacobian? So it's linear forms on the differentials, holomorphic differentials, modulo homology. So I give you a linear form that takes every differential. The natural thing to do is to integrate between the point penultcunu, this differential, and then make the sum. Okay. This is a linear form on the differentials. Okay, and then to do that modulo homology. Okay. Yes. Okay. This is actually how Abel-Jacobi started to study this, by studying these integrals. So the theorem is that this map induces an isomorphism between peak zero. So peak zero, you make the quotient and the Jacobian. Peak zero of C. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So in other words, the kernel of this map, it's precisely the principal divisors. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that also makes sense because you integrate, it has to do with the fundamental theorem of the calculus. I'm not gonna do the details, but okay, that is the result. Then alternatively, you can also define alpha dn from cn into the Jacobian. So what is cn? cn is a symmetric group. So you take cn times modulo the symmetric group Sn. So on order points. On order. N tuples. Or you can also say effective divisors. This is the defective divisors on C. Effective. And defective divisors. So you take a formal sum of points. N points, which could be repeated, right, with some multiplicity. And then you go to this functional. So what do? You integrate again, but you have a fixed point C. C, P, no, it's omega. On modulo homology. So Dn, Dn is a divisor of degree n, which is n times a point. So the point is fixed. Okay, this is another way of defining it. Okay, let's see if I can arrive. Mm-hmm. We have more maps. You can also go to from the effective divisor of degree n into peak n. So what is peak n? Peak n is line bundles of degree n on C. Yeah. And you take every effective divisor, you choose to take the associated line bundle. Okay. So you know that the inverse image of a line bundle is just going to be its linear series or linear system. What we call linear system of L is the set of all effective divisors. Linear equivalent to the effective divisors, linear equivalent to L. So that they have, equivalent to L. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, I wanted to finish in a more precise note. There is something I'm going to use later. Is the following proposition that the projectivized differential of the Abel premap or of the Abel-Jacobi map. Mm-hmm. So the Abel-Jacobi map that goes, so you can, this what I describe here, alpha dn, you can for n equals one. So for n equals one, you have an embedding of the curve into the Jacobian when you fix a point of the curve. Okay, so you fix a point C and you take the line bundle associated to the difference of these two points for a fixed C is fixed. Okay, so this is the Abel-Jacobi map, and the differential, so the projectivized of the differential. So what is it? So you have to put the differentials of alpha C. You have to projectivize the tangent to C, the tangent bundle to C. So is essentially is you can identify to the curve because in every point of the curve you have a line, a tangent line, and you projectivize this line, it's just the point itself goes to the projectivize of the tangent of the Jacobian. So we put this tangent of the Jacobian. Mm-hmm. So the tangent of the Jacobian we know because the tangent to the Jacobian in one point, let's say 0 point or any point, is isomorphic to the vector space itself, right? What do you call it? The C space of holomorphic differentials dual. So you projectivize the dual of this. So yes. And the tangent is because we have these translations. Is a trivial bundle. So you have the Jacobian times Yes, how I wanted to write it properly. Mm-hmm. Okay. So what I mean, okay, of course you have, so maybe it's not so clear, but what I say, this map is actually the canonical map. So every curve comes with a canonical divisor, a canonical sheaf, and does give you a canonical map between, defined by the Lagrange. Usually it's embedding, but not always, into P of A0 omega C. Which is PG minus one. This is just a very nice proposition. We want to use later. I'm sorry, I'm over time, I think, a little bit, not so much. But maybe I will finish here. Is there any questions?
I have a stupid question.
Yeah, please.
Can you remind us what is the projectivation of TC? Do you mean the projectivation of a vector bundle on another stuff?
Yeah, of the vector bundle. Yes. So so the differential of any map goes from the tangent bundle from one to the tangent bundle to other. Yes. Okay. So you put yourself in one point. So what I want to projectivize, I want to projectivize that bundle. And by that, I mean, I projectivize every fiber. Yes. Every fiber of the bundle for, yes. So, on the left side, well, there is nothing to, when you projectivize a tangent to the point, well, it's the point itself, there is nothing to do. And on the other side, what you projectivize is this part. So this gives you the base point. So you have a base point. So you get, okay, maybe you go from C, this point, and you take point P. This is a point in the Jacobian, and then you projectivize this one here. So what I mean is this should be the given by the sections of this bundle. So what's the section? Yeah, so did I give names? Yeah, some section of homogenize, yes, because I projectivize this part. Yes. So what is nice of the Jacobian is the tangent to any point is isomorphic to the differentials because you get all the by translating. And you projectivize that. You projectivize this part here. Okay, so and the canonical map, I mean, the canonical map is the second part. The point is fixed, is this part. This is the canonical map. Yeah, so you take a point and you go to, you get a section, a basis of sections, or basis of differentials. Oh, is this gross? This P is not good. How many you have? So you have, you start in one, you have G. That's right. Yes.
Omega zero.
Omega zero. Yeah, I should start omega zero.
No.
It's the same. Yeah, start in one. Okay. G is a speech. Yeah, it's homogenized. It's homogeneous.
Homogeneous. No, the are correct. No. Now it's all clear. Thank you.
Is it clear? Okay. Yes. Yeah, so this projectivized differential, one has to understand it on each fiber, essentially. On each fiber. Yes. Okay. Other questions?
Thank you.
Sorry, I have a question. So on yes. The right-hand side, it's a projectivization of the tangent bundle. So is it the product of the Jacobian with the PG minus one?
Yes. Yes.
So the canonical map is actually the projection to the PG minus one.
Yes, the canonical map, well, the canonical map is defined by sections of these differentials.
Sorry, Angela, maybe
that's a question. Yeah.
Yes, maybe here you have to compose with the second projection, right? From the canonical projective bundle to PG minus one.
Yes.
From the trivial.
Yes, from the trivial, yes. Yes, I put it here, but yes, I think to make it clear. So essentially I should, sorry for the mess, but here you have to project into the second one, yes. To the second factor. So the projectivization of H5, this composition is the canonical map. Mm-hmm. That's right. I hope it's clear. Is it clear what I mean by?
Yes. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. This is why I don't have written notes, because all my notes will be much better than here. So I should. Good. So I am a little bit behind my plan. I just want to talk a little bit about the Theta divisor, which is the next step, not so much more. And the next step tomorrow come the prime varieties. So I will tell you what the prime variety is and the prime map. Today feels like a little bit in a hurry because there are a lot of background, but I hope it will slow down and be more concrete. More questions? Okay. Good then. I think you have the exercise session with Pavel tomorrow, and feel free to ask him all the questions. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.